So as Peter went through all parts of the country, he also came down to the saints who dwelt in Lydia. There he found a certain man named Aeneas, who had been bedridden for 8 years and was paralyzed. Peter said to him, "Aeneas, Jesus the Christ heals you. Arise and make your bed." Then he arose immediately. So all who dwelt in Lydia and Sharon saw him and turned to the Lord. At Joppa, there was a certain disciple named Thaddeus. There, which is translated as Dorcas, this woman, who was full of good works and charitable deeds, which she did, but it happened in those days that she became sick and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in the upper room, and since Lydia was near Joppa, and the disciples had heard that Peter was there, they sent two men to him, imploring him not to delay in coming to them. Then Peter arose and went to them. When he had come, they brought him to the upper room, and with all the widows stood by weeping, showing the tunics and garments of Dorcas he had made while she was with them. But Peter put them all out and knelt and prayed, then turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, arise." And she opened her eyes. And when she saw Peter, she sat up. Then he gave her his hand and lifted her up. And when he had called the saints and widows, he presented her alive. And it became known through all Joppa, and many believed on the Lord. Beloved, that which from the beginning, which we had heard, which we had seen with our own eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, concerning the word and life, life was manifested, and we had seen and bear witness, and declare to you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested to us, that which we have seen and we have heard, and we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and the Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be fulfilled. This is the message which we have heard from him who declared to you that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we had said that we had fellowship with him and walked in darkness, we would lie, and we did not practice the truth. But if we walk in light as he is in light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin.
Peace to your reader. Alleluia. 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 Waiting for the movement of the water. There was one man who had been sick for 38 years. And Jesus knew the man had been sick for a long time, said when he saw him lying there, "Do you want to be healed?" "Sir," the sick man answered, "I do not have anyone to plunge me to the pool once the water has been stirred up. By the time I get there, someone else has gone in ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, pick up your mat and walk." The man was immediately cured. He picked up his mat and began to walk. The day was a Sabbath. Consequently, some of the Jews began telling the man who had been cured, "It is the Sabbath, and you are not allowed to carry your mat along around." He explained, "It was the man who cured me who told me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.' This person who told you, 'Pick up and walk,' they asked, 'Who is he?' The man who has been restored to health had no idea who he was." The crowd in the place was so great that Jesus had been able to slip away. Later on, Jesus found the man in the temple precincts and said to him, "Remember now, you have been cured. Give up your sins so that something worse might not overtake you." The man went off and informed the Jews that Jesus was the man who cured him. Families as requested from their estate. But really, the announcement is, well, Saturday, I know it's hard to, Saturday evening, it's considered a Sunday. So this is a Sunday in Divine Liturgy. So for all the months, really, this is your day. And I feel bad because it should not be just once a year on this magic day, you know, is it what, the second Sunday of May. But it's really, I hope and pray that your children, your spouses, and everyone around you really acknowledges your motherhood every single day. Because I thought in the beginning, you know, mom and dad are, well, what's the difference, right? They both have a task. Big difference, you know. I think being a mom is so special. So may God bless you. And we do remember you in our prayers every single day. But may God give you a really, really special power, the spiritual power to carry as a mother, to love and to protect and to teach and to do everything good what a mother is supposed to be. God really continues you to bless you for many, many, many years. In the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. So as we continue to celebrate Christ's resurrection, the Church directs us today to another event on this Sunday. The Savior's healing of a man who had been paralyzed, as the Gospel says, 38 years. The man was lying by the pool of water where he could have been healed. But due to his paralysis, he was unable to enter the water first, because you'd have to, when the angel comes and stir the water, you have to be first to get into that water. Christ died and rose in order to heal the fallen, spiritually weak, sick, and then slain. So we typically lack the strength to fulfill our calling to become like God in holiness. But that's what you and I were created by being born, to be God-like. And we certainly cannot overcome the temptations of our world, without God's strength. The Old Testament and sacrificial worship of the temple foreshadows the coming of Christ. However, they lacked power to heal the soul from the destruction of sin. Christ fulfilled them both as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Our great high priest offered himself on the cross as he entered fully into death itself, for which he liberated us by his resurrection to become partakers of the divine nature by grace. He did so purely out of love for humanity in order to restore and fulfill us in God's image and likeness. So this paralytic, this paralyzed man embodies our common human condition. This fellow did not call to Christ for help. Many times we come to a point in our life, we stop praying, we stop calling to Christ to help us. We just kind of sunk in and then nothing will change. So he did not call Christ to help him, nor he did not even know the Christ name. Lord graciously reached out to him, asking really the obvious question, do you want to be healed? The Savior's words call us all into question. Because it is easy to embrace our distorted main desires and to apply our habitual sins to the point that they become second nature of us. Some people seem to do this when they express their pride and or the hatred to those they see as their enemies. And that could be political, that could be cultural or racial or circles. Some of us think it is virtuous to be trapped by whatever love we have. And that could be love of money, love of, I'm sure, false deities, while holding needy and humble neighbors in contempt. So in order to accept his mercy, we must refuse to identify ourselves in terms of our misdirected passions and instead struggle to obey the Lord's command. And the command is, rise, take up your pallet, and walk. No matter how great the struggle, we must rise in obedience in order to participate in the Savior's liberation from the paralysis of sin and death. He does not force us to do so. However, it is your choice. Lying still for a long time makes people weak and unable to move on their own. The same is true of us spiritually if we do not undertake the struggle to live and serve Him as faithfully as He desires us to do so. The more accustomed we become to any of our sins, the more the sins become part of us, and the weaker we will become. The longer we insist on remaining enslaved to our extreme passions, the less inclined we will be open to receiving the liberation that the Savior gave us when He died and rose on the third day. So as you know, stretching weak muscles makes them tired and sore. Continue to do that guarantees that they will remain weak. So in order to attain the strength and function that we want, we simply have to push the limits of our weaknesses to positive directions. That is true of us both physically and spiritually. After a lifetime of not moving, the paralyzed man could not have found it easy to obey Christ's command to get up, to pick up his bed, and to walk. He had learned how to survive as being an invalid. But now the Savior was directing him to a very different life, the challenges of which he could not know or even predict. At some level, he must have struggled with fear and uncertainty for what would lie ahead for him. We'll probably feel the same way in our journey to seek clarity and strength. The more we embrace Christ's healing, the more we become aware of the journey to betterment we must follow. The Lord commands us, follow this path, not from time to time, but daily, every day of our life. As He is God and man, He is also our guide for healing, restoration, and fulfillment. Entrusting ourselves to the Savior requires that we refuse to live like those who hope for nothing beyond the grave, and therefore will embrace any appealing distraction from despair about the ultimate pointlessness of their existence. By his resurrection, Christ frees us from anxiety fueled by the fear of death, and calls us to the hard work of reorienting our lives each day, and share more fully in the joy of his salvation. We must lay aside all the distractions and excuses from doing so that we receive from our own thoughts and inclinations, and also from the many voices across the ideological spectrum in our culture. We must mindfully cultivate and settle desire to be healed of all that corrupts our souls, even as we continue taking the necessary steps of obedience, even as difficult as they may be. We must not rest content with our present level of spiritual health, but must continually push ourselves forward as we turn our attention away from anything that could hold us back. And from time to time, I remind myself and people who come to confession, perhaps, that there's a difference between one person and one person. I know there is a famous, well, we are from some Three Amigos, you know, beautiful restaurant just a few blocks away from the church. And if someone goes there daily and they have a different kind of a ethical or moral understanding, but you have different. So you and I will be judged by our level, not that level. So many times we compare ourselves, well, how I'm, you know, he or she does, or, you know, so I'm not as bad, but no, it's not really about him or her, it's about me and my journey towards God. It's about me and my understanding, my deepness, and the holier. The life should be getting holier and holier and holier. Each time you leave the church, people around you should notice the difference. Wow, what happened to him or her? He, she is, there's some sort of brightness, some light coming of that. That's the reason of coming to church, to really recharge yourself with that holiness of resurrected Christ. So in order to continue to celebrate Easter, we must participate personally in the Lord's victory over the corrupting power of death and sin, by actually obeying him. By his resurrection, the Savior has enabled us all to rise from our beds of sin and bear witness to something radically new that has come into the world through the cross and his empty tomb. All that we must do is to take the steps that we can to embrace the life of the risen Lord. That is how we will come to know our weaknesses and open ourselves to receive his strength, which can never earn or fully deserve. That is how we will enter to the great joy of this Easter season, for Christ is risen. Let us all sing with our whole soul, whole mind, let us sing. the patriarchs as well, most reverend and father of the Lord, God loving Bishop Brian, all those in priestly, diaconal, religious, and monastic orders, our receiving the Lord, this new armed forces, blessed founders, benefactors of this holy church, all of the Orthodox Christians, now and forever and ever.
Our prayer to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
is for love for you and for many, for their forgiveness of sins. Especially if I was holy, my woman, blessed Lord Lady, the Mother of God and ever Virgin Mary.
Grant this, O Lord,
and guide your come, all rooted in the goodness of God. Let us pray to the Lord. That we may spend the rest of our lives in peace and repentance. Let us ask the Lord. For a Christian and our lives, one is painless, unashamedly peaceful, for a good defense and an awesome tribunal of Christ. Let us ask the Lord. Having asked for unity, faith, fellowship of the Holy Spirit, let us commend ourselves and one another and our whole life to Christ our God.
Do you,
O Lord, be worthy, Master, with confidence, with all the nation, to there call you, Heavenly God, Father, and say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever.
Amen.
Jesus Christ,
Jesus,
the Lord,
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 Lord
save your people, O God, and bless your inheritance. Christ is risen.
Saint George, great martyr and patron of